Hey, what's up everyone? This is Vice91 here, and welcome back to Let's Play Skies of Arcadia Legends. Last time we made some upgrades to our base and whatnot, and actually this time we are looking to do... let's see, what do I want to do? I think I was trying to decide if I wanted to do some discovery hunting or just advance the plot. I think last time we decided that we were going to go after the Yellow Crystal through subterranean tunnels in Valua. Now that our Delphinus can go above and below the clouds, but I think that's going to have to wait a little while because I feel like doing a little bit of discovery hunting. So I think we are going to actually fill out the rest of our discovery log. So let's take a look and see where we are with that right now. Let's take a look at the journal and check out the discoveries. Let's see. We have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 16 plus 6 more, that's 24, 27, 31, 34 more discoveries that are just begging to be discovered. And I think we are going to tackle them all this episode. Are you excited? I am. Because not only does that mean that we'll be done with our discovery log, that means we are going to bring in a haul of cash from selling all this information. So, what I'm going to do is I don't really know what kind of order I'm going to go in. I'm just going to kind of wander around. But I won't bring you guys along for the entire duration of the travel. I'm pretty much just going to hit the highlights whenever I finally make it upon all of these discoveries. But first, actually, you know what? I'm going to try to get one real quick that I might know has shown up right now. It's that one that I was looking for, that moving discovery that I was looking for on top of Valua. It's right next to the sky ladder that we discovered last time. But it's a moving discovery. I think it might even go all the way around the world. I'm not entirely sure on that, but I know that it comes right by the sky ladder. And I think its position resets every time you start the game to show up right around here, but I may have already missed it. It actually moves pretty fast. So I can't remember what direction it comes from. I think it comes from the north. But I'm seeing nothing. It's looking like I might have to just circle back to this one a little bit later. I can come back and get that one later. That's not too big of a deal. Alright, but first I am actually going to, while I'm in the Valua area, I'm going to descend below the cloud floor because there's a few things to find underneath here. One of them should become pretty obvious here in just a moment. Where are you? I know it gets really dark around this area, so it's kind of hard to see. Ah, there we go. That's what I'm looking for. These two lights just kind of dancing in a circle here. And what do you know? They're called the dancing lights. A natural phenomenon that can be seen underneath the Valuan continent, it is said to be caused by electricity from the yellow moonstones in the Valuan soil. Some say that it is caused by a giant creature that lies deep inside the ground. Interesting. Alright, well, right here, if you look straight through here, actually, there's a little, you know, inverse canyon that you can go through, and you might see an opening in the ground right ahead of us. Well, that is actually our next destination. That's the underground entrance to the Maw of Tartus. So that is our next destination to advance the story, but like I said, today, we're not quite ready to do that. We're going to knock out all these discoveries first, but we will be back here soon. But if you go straight north from the dancing lights, and kind of stay close to the ceiling of the rock here, we're just going to keep mashing the A button until we find the rabbits. A strange creature that spends its entire life hanging upside down by digging its claws into the rock face. Until it was discovered underneath the Valuan continent, it was thought to be a myth. Its intelligence and ferocity belie its cute appearance. That kind of is cute. Very interesting little creature there. Alright, well, those are the only two that are found underneath Valua. And now is the time that I'm going to start. Actually, you see there's kind of some fish down here, a little, like, seahorse-looking fish. that are actually pretty rare. They're A-grade fish. Anyway. Alright, now's the time that I'm going to start cutting away until I see some discoveries, and once I get there, I will show you where I found them. So I'll see you in this rapid-fire discovery challenge. Alright, here we have found the Stone City. The ruins of a settlement built into a solid rock wall with callous passageways connecting the dwellings. The homes appear to have been abandoned hastily, but no evidence has been found that explains exactly what happened. Interesting. And here we are at the very northern shore of the Bloomin' Continent, kind of in the middle. It's where the coastline starts to turn into kind of an icy little area there. But here we are on the map here. Alright, time for the next one. Alright, and we have found the Philosophy Stone. Though my body may age and the sun may set, the soul of a sailor still burns inside me. As long as I can dream, I shall travel the skies. As long as there are skies, my journey shall continue. A Sailor's Philosophy by Anonymous. This is on a tiny little island that's northwest of the Stone City we were just at. And it's a little bit north of the Bloomin' Continent, so right here, not too far from where we just were. Alright, time for the next one. Alright, and we have found a giant squid nest. We thought it was just a big rock, but when we threw the anchor, this huge eyeball opened up and those red legs came out of nowhere. We just ran for it and barely made it out with our ship in one piece. An anonymous sailor. Huh, interesting. There it is, floating up there, kind of this squid legs trying to jump out of there. Well, where there is a squid nest, there must be a squid, right? Well, if you look over here to the west, this will be a little bit of a detour from our discoveries, but you see there is a giant squid roaming the skies out here. Actually, before I engage with this guy, I am going to... I have the white map on, so let me switch over to Captain's hat for advice real quick. And remember that kind of interesting-looking creature that we battled against in the Land of Ice? Alania? Kind of that spidery-looking guy? Well, this is another of the giant monsters that's roaming the world. The giant squid. Ah! That squid's huge! It's bigger than our ship! I've heard stories about a giant squid, but I never actually believed any of them. Alright, everyone, battle stations! Alright, we gotta take this thing down, huh? Okay, well, let's see here. We can go ahead and get Urala off in the first turn. That's nice. So let's go ahead and do that. We'll wrap that up at the very end there. And let's see, what else would I like to do here? Shoot, I guess I can't really do anything, huh? Well, I guess I'll guard for a few turns. Yay. But this giant squid's name is Obispo. And it's just kind of wandering up here, minding its own business. But you know us, we gotta stick our nose in everything here. But hey, it did look like it wanted to fight, so we will gladly oblige. Not really doing anything yet, but neither is he. Oh, here we go, squidding. Squirts all this nasty ink on us, and well, that's about as much damage as you would expect that attack to do. Meaningless 1240 damage, but it's just ink. I mean, it's not like a cannon shell or anything like that. That's pretty much pathetic. But it's sticking to its guns, and that's just what it's gonna roll with. But nothing to really worry about there. And wow. 70 spirit points will be available to us in the next round. Very nice, very nice. Alright. So we don't really have an opportunity for the Moonstone Cannon, but you know what? That's alright. That's not going to stop us from doing anything. So we are going to unleash some attacks here. And I do want to buff up real quick, so I'm going to do that. And I'm going to fire this torpedo. That should be pretty good, I think. I'm not going to bother with drill or anything like that. This thing should work fine. This thing really shouldn't take too long to dispatch. I do like how its tentacles are kind of doing that very, you know, hypnotic pattern there. I kind of like that. I thought squids had... How many tentacles do squids have? Because this one only has 7. And we are chopping it down. And as you can tell, the more damage we do, it starts losing tentacles. Which sounds awful, really. But that change is just cosmetic. That doesn't really have anything to do with how strong it is or anything like that. Ah, our subcannon missed. That's kind of disappointing, but down go 3 more tentacles. Poor squid. But hey, shouldn't be picking fights. And you keep shooting ink at us, so we're gonna fight back. Come on. You need a new attack, though, dude. That's just not cutting it. Alright, so... doesn't that thing know when to give up? It's already lost one leg and it's still attacking us. That one tentacle alone could probably feed us for a month. What a waste. That's a good point. Well, the Moonstone Cannon's available next turn, but I don't think we're going to get there. Because we're going to kind of go all out here. Aw, man, we can't fire the torpedo? That's too bad. But nothing that a pyro bomb can't take care of. Yeah, sorry, Obispo, you're going down. Not really sure how you would even procure those tentacle legs, though, Vice. I mean, yeah, it's a waste, but what are you going to do? How are you going to bring that back to a town? And down goes Obispo. And he's exploding. What? Okay. Alright. Vice gains a level, and we get an alloy deck. Huh. Let's check that out. I wonder how much better or worse that's going to be than what we already have here. Let's take a look. Versus the compound deck we have, it is... Oh, wow, it's a nice little upgrade. Plus 30 to what we already had. So, yeah, let's go ahead and throw that on there. All right. And while I'm in the area... I think just around where he was, there's this kind of... Oh, I see it there. This fish that's kind of roaming the sky down here. This isn't a fish that you can catch, it's actually a discovery. This is the ancient fish. A species of fish that was believed to have been extinct millions of years ago. Its vestigial gills and fins that look like hands and feet seem to point to an evolutionary path from the waters to the dry land and then to the skies. It's pretty interesting. And just as a reference here, we're in this kind of very southern part of the map here. That's where the giant squid is, and that ancient fish, and the giant squid nest. Alright, moving on! Here, hanging out in upper sky, we have found the Ghost Ship. An unmanned shipwreck that continues to wander the skies. Many sailors tell of a ghost ship that appeared suddenly from the fog. Some claim that it was once the ship of the great air pirate Dekat, but no evidence has been found to support it. Well, you know what? I would believe that, because Dekat was one of the greatest air pirates of all time, and this thing's hanging out in upper sky where no ship can travel except for the Yafutoman ships and our ship, really. So it's just kind of hanging out here above the Dark Rift. So I think it kind of wanders along the Dark Rift in this path. It may even kind of go up towards the Nasser Kingdom, but that's where I found it. So on to the next one. Alright, I'm hanging out here in lower sky in the Land's Vice area, and remember we saw this island earlier, kind of below the clouds that we couldn't get to earlier? Well, this is actually a discovery. This is the Southern Cross. A mysterious cross-shaped island, the building that sits atop is said to be a remnant of the Purple Civilization. Legends say that the long arm of the cross points toward the location of that civilization, but no one has ever confirmed it. Well, I can actually confirm that in just a moment, but first, I'm going to go a little bit further west. There is one more discovery that's a short little fly away here. There's this little snow spout Just a little bit further down here, this is another discovery. This is the deep snow. In the sky deep beneath the lands of ice, a white substance rises up from beneath the clouds like some sort of secret fountain. It only appears in one specific place, making it even more difficult to understand. That is kind of difficult to understand. But, let's see, let's go back to the Southern Cross. There's actually one more thing that I'd like to point out about this area. Where is it? It's just straight east of here, right? Where was I? Oh, here it is. Alright, so it said that the log part of the island was actually pointing towards the civilization, the purple civilization, so let's follow it here. And actually, if we come far enough here, we can actually see the Lands of Ice area, Glacia. But we gotta find it first. Somewhere over here. And actually, once we find it, if we ever do find it, there is an underground entrance to Glacia. Oh, it looks like I missed it. Here we go. So it kind of looks cool from down here, doesn't it? But actually, we can enter this place from underground, the Ruins of Ice, and it doesn't come to the same place that we were earlier. This is actually an alternate entrance. So there's these doors over here that if we come straight forward, there's actually a treasure chest that we couldn't get to earlier with a moonberry in it. And not only that, there's also a moonfish. So don't forget to come check this out. This is really the only place that this extra entrance offers. There is one of these platforms that will take you straight across, and that is the entrance that we came through the first time we were here. So it can bring you back there if you want. But that's only if you want to explore this place once again. So, you know, there's nothing too meaningful about that. Don't forget to come grab that moonberry and that moonfish, because it can be easily forgotten. While we are in the area, let me get out of this place here. See the best way to get out of here. Wow, that doesn't really help me at all. I just want to get out of here because there's one more discovery that you can find in upper sky in this area. And that's what I'm going to grab right in just a minute. And there's actually something else that I would like to point out while we are in the area. We're not going to take care of it just yet. There's the aurora that we found our first time through this area. And let's see. Actually, what I'm looking for, the second thing I was looking for isn't here yet. That's okay. I wasn't going to worry about that just yet anyway. Let's see if I can gain my bearings here. I'm looking for a mountain that's sticking out of the cloud ceiling. Ah, here we go. This is what I'm looking for. You're looking for the tallest peak in this area, because there's a discovery right on top of it. This is the Tomb of Ice, a coffin of ice built by a father who could not bear his sorrow. The girl encased within the ice bears an expression almost resembling a smile. Etched into a tablet sealed within are the words, "My daughter, may your beauty be eternal." It's kind of creepy, but I guess, you know, kind of, I don't know, kind of nice? Anyway, on to the next discovery. Here we have the Moonstone Lake, a truly rare sight, a waterfall that runs through a vein of moonstone. The water plunges from above to carry away bits of moonstone, and it is said to have mystic attributes. It is believed that those who drink the water enjoy a long life. This is hanging out in upper sky, in the central part of the world, close to Pirate Isle. So Pirate Isle is right here, and here's where we are. Okay, next one. And here we have the Flying Machine. An odd-looking ship whose origins remain a complete mystery. The fluid design and strange metals used in its hull have led to theories of a ship built of another world, and some even go so far as to say that it traveled through areas without air. Huh. It sounds kind of weird, but okay. This is on a small little island here next to this giant vortex in lower sky underneath the Shrine Island, which you can see at the top of the screen there. Alright, on to the next one. And here we have the Bottomless Pit. A chimney-like rocky mountain with a hollow center rising up from the great cloud sea. From the depths of the pit, it is said that a woman's weeping can be heard in the wind. Could this be the mythical entrance to the land of the dead? Here it is right here. I'm hanging out kind of in the central area of the world again, right here, a little bit west of Shrine Island, in under sky, lower sky, whatever. You know what I mean. All right, next one. And here we have the Alupas, an ancient species that predates the Ixitakan civilization. The Alupas live quietly in the forest. Their calm, proud demeanor has earned them the name Sages of the Forest. They are also known for choosing their mates for life. So this thing's hanging out on this giant island here in upper sky in Ixitaka region. Trust me, you won't miss that island. And while we are here, there should be another one pretty close by on, I believe, one of these islands that's sticking up next to Rixus. Yep, the Observatory. A civilization once flourished in this land under the Green Moon. The observatory built on the Ixitakan Plateau speaks to their advanced study of astronomy, but they could do not but watch as a shower of moonstones destroyed their culture. And here you can actually see that temple that's above Rixus there, so that's kind of neat. Alright, and here, a little bit further north, you see a giant bird hanging up there. Well, we're getting the notification that it's pissed off that we're in its area. So, let's see here. Let's actually, I'm at decent health, but what I will do is I'm actually going to save. Just real quick here. Just because it's been about half an hour since I started, and I want to kind of keep updated anyway. Alright, but this is actually, if you remember in North Ocean when we were going through the first time, we found a discovery called the Rock's Nest. Well, this is the rock. What is that thing? I've never seen a bird this big before. I don't know, but it looks like he's hungry. Yeah, it sure does. Okay, well, this is the rock, like I said. And actually what we're going to do, we're going to do things a little bit differently this time. We're gonna use Urala here. And we're gonna guard, and I'm gonna heal up just a little bit, just because here. I can't sort the items on here, that's kind of disappointing. I'll just use a deluxe kit. I just need to do a little bit of healing, not too much. Now, I have no clue how long this episode is going to last, because I'm going to be cutting away, and here's the rock's first attack, the blast voice, which is an interesting attack for a bird to have, but I guess, you know, you hear birds chirping and whatever all the time, so maybe that kind of goes along with that, but, you know, it's just his voice, so it's not really doing hardly anything to our ship. So anyway, I'm cutting away to 30-plus discoveries during this episode. And just if I spend a minute on each one of those describing where it is and what it is, that's 30 minutes right there, plus this battle and the battle with the giant squid. And, you know, I don't know how long this episode's going to be. Hopefully it's not too long. But if it is too long, well, I don't really know what I'm going to do. I may just end up leaving it as one huge long episode. It may end up being like an hour long or something like that, but I think it's kind of important that I tie all of this stuff up in one episode. But we'll see. We'll cross that bridge when we get there. I may split the other, you know, the alternative to that would be splitting it up into two parts, but I don't know if I'm going to do that. But we'll see. And he keeps using that blast voice attack, but it's not bothering me. That scream, it's too powerful. No, it's not, Bias. It's barely scratching us. It's going to tear the ship apart. It's still coming after us. He must be really, really hungry. I don't think he really wants to eat us. I think he's just mad that we're, you know, hanging out in his area here. Alright, so we're going to use Incremus, and we're going to use Drill Mouse at some point here. Here we go. We're gonna do that, and then we're gonna regain some of that SP that we lost, and hopefully get an opportunity to use the Moonstone Cannon next round. And then we are going to demolish this thing. here's its other attack, the grab. Now, you can understand this may be a little more damaging than his scream, and rightfully so. It does 5,000 damage. But I would be a lot more concerned about that than I would be about his scream attack. I mean, because look at the talents on that thing. So hopefully it doesn't do that attack too often.
Nope, okay, I'm okay with him using this blast voice. That's not bothering me one bit.
I like how our ship kind of like droops, like it's like, Anyway, we should have maxed out spirit again next round, so that should be good. I want to get off the Moonstone Cannon and keep blasting this guy. I have more than just a voice attack that I can use, bucko. Nice, waiting orders, what should we do? Okay, we are going to take that thing straight on, because you know what? Take that thing head on. Let's aim for its head. Well, I suppose we have to take a risk sometime. Just watch out for its attacks, okay, Vice?
Yeah.
I want to get off the Moonstone Cannon. That's what I'm worried about. So let's do that. And then we're going to keep shredding this guy. And that should be good. Alright. Well, Vice was right. We certainly aimed for its head. We missed a little bit, but still 30,000 damage is quite useful. Here it is with that voice attack. I mean, goodness. Is your throat not getting sore by now? Be standing there. You get another 10,000 damage to your face. Oh, well, hopefully we turn around here pretty quickly or else we're going to lose the target here. God, that's kind of a wicked looking attack. I mean, it really has control of us when it does that. Come on, turn around. Turn around. Oh, man, we're going to miss. Yep, we lost the target there that round because we were facing the opposite direction. Looks like we're trying to turn around. I hope we do, or else we're going to basically waste a ton of spirit points this next round, but hopefully the torpedo at least still hits them. Okay, good. Oh yeah, see ya. And once again, the rock spirals and explodes down to the sky. And, you know, it begs the question once again that, are these the last of their species, because we're just traveling the world eradicating the final ones of these species, rendering them extinct. I mean, that's kind of a jerk move there. And we got a wooden doll, which is just another luxury item, so it's not really going to add much in terms of defense or anything like that. So, alright, that's in the bank. On to more discoveries. And here we have the Looper's Nest. Loopers are mysterious creatures rarely seen even by the most seasoned of sailors. They nest in stone reefs, and their young stay in the nest until they mature. Loopers are white at birth, but turn various colors as they age. It's kind of cool. And there's the nest down there. And right now, we're actually in an area that we have not yet been in. We're in this top left corner of the world that's completely segregated off by the Dark Rift and the white stone reef that actually comes up a little bit further north here. It kind of separates this triangular area here. And we have not been here yet, but something interesting about this area is that all random battles that you will encounter in this area will be against loopers. It can be various, you know, loopers, all different colors and whatever. So this is actually a good spot to level up. Here, I'll just show you a quick example here. And you may have noticed the giant looper that was flying around in the sky right before we got in this battle. But here you see, we have six loopers, all different colors. So let's see here. I'm going to do a Delta Shield because the blue ones can cast Slipara. So I want to stay away from that. And actually, I didn't equip the black map, so a good bit of them may run away here. But If you want to do some hardcore leveling up, this is a great place to do it. It also is a great source of gold if you want to, you know, if you're looking to buy something or whatever. But this is a good place to do it. And there is one battle, one type of battle that you can get in this area, which is against 7 purple loopers, which is the best case scenario that you could possibly hope for, because each one of them offers 500 experience. So if you take down those guys in that battle, that's 3,500 experience just for that one battle. And it's not all that rare to run into 7 purple loopers in this area. So if you want to hang out here, oh yeah, that's Ryukan's sword that he made for us. I'm not sure if you have seen that yet, but we bought that from his store that he set up in Crescent Isle. So a great spot to do some leveling. And here we have a giant looper. So this is actually the fourth giant monster, the fourth and final giant monster that's hanging out in the area, in the world. So look at this guy. I guess this must be like Mama Looper or something like that. But anyway, something interesting. Now, you know, loopers are kind of a unique enemy to come across in, you know, in random battles and whatnot. Well, this guy is no different. This looper is a little bit odd. First of all, it has this ability that it will do. You'll see it in just a moment. I'll point out when it happens. But it kind of makes this battle a little bit difficult. Nope, doesn't do it yet, but here's its attack, Looper Wing. And here it looks like it's going to do it here. No? Okay, it didn't do it. Sometimes, I'll go ahead and just describe what happens. It will basically like dart down to the bottom of the sky to where, you know, it kind of goes into hiding. And it'll do that very rapidly, so that if you're firing a cannon or something at some point, you won't be able to hit it because it's, you know, kind of running away, or there it goes. So it's not running away from battle, it's just running away from your attacks. So if I were to fire a cannon during that turn, it would have missed. And then it will pop back up in one of these other rings. So another thing about this battle is that you only have... Basically, whenever you start hurting it, you basically have one round from the first impact of when you start hurting it to finish him off. Let's see here. What do I want to do? Actually, I'm going to want that Moonstone Cannon pretty bad. So, I need to do Inkrum for sure. And I need to do... I don't think I'm going to worry about Drill, because I'm kind of worried that may scare him off. So, I don't know what I'm going to do. I guess I'll guard, because I don't need the Spirit, and I don't need to attack. What I will do is fire a torpedo, because that won't hit him. And I guess I'll guard again. But anyway, after the first time you actually attack him, that'll kind of make him scare that he's under attack or whatever. So you have pretty much one more round after the first attack to take him out, or else he will run away from battle. And the only way to make him reappear is to enter a town or something like that, and then come back into the area, and he'll be back. But you don't want him to run away. So the key to this is to concentrate your firepower into basically one round, so that you can take him out. That's what I'm going to try to do with next round with that Moonstone Cannon opportunity. I'm going to fire the Moonstone. I'm firing the torpedo at the end of this round so that it can stack on the Moonstone Cannon hit. And then I'll fire a Sub Cannon at the beginning of next round to hopefully stack on top of that. Hopefully that should be enough to take care of it. If not, then I will probably be in some trouble. But we'll see what happens. Alright, here we go. So So time to see what we can do here. Alright, so hopefully this does the job here. I don't think he can run away mid-turn, so even if this doesn't take him out in just a second, or if we keep missing or something like that, hopefully he doesn't run away. But I don't think he can run away in the middle of the turn, so we should be okay as long as we can get this Moonstone Cannon off and maybe one other cannon after that, but I'm thinking this will be enough to take him out here. I like that. You see how the torpedo came in at the top of the screen there? That was kind of neat. It didn't look like it was anywhere near the target, though, so it had to have missed. No, it didn't. All right, so 50,000 damage, and down goes the giant looper. And we get a thermal grease, a captain strike, wow, and a hex shell. So we're going to go ahead and use that captain strike there while I'm thinking about it. Alright, so up to 52,000 there. Okay, so there's a couple more discoveries in this area that I'd like to go ahead and grab. But first I need to relocate the looper's nest because that will help me find this next discovery. Alright, so here I am right here. Now I think if I go straight north from here, and I kind of have to hang out just below the cloud ceiling here, but there should be a point where the screen flickers black, and it should be what I'm looking for. This one's kind of difficult to find, but I think it's directly north of the looper's nest. Alright. Oh, here we go. Alright, awesome. I found the eclipse point. It was just a little bit further north than when I got in that battle. The only place in the world where a lunar eclipse can be observed at predictable intervals. Eclipses where a golden ring can be seen around the moon are seen as good omens, and complete eclipses are said to portend an impending disaster. That doesn't sound too good. I think if you... there should be... like, right where you find it, the screen should turn, like, completely dark, but... looks like I found it anyway at some point. Anyway, that one's kind of difficult to find, but just go north of a looper's nest and you should get there, no problem. Alright, there's one more discovery in this area. I'm just kind of avoiding battles for the moment, but it's going to be close to the dark rift up here in the top left corner. And it kind of floats, it's moving, it's visible, but it kind of floats above the dark rift here and kind of dips below in this area, in the looper area, looper land, if you will. But then it'll kind of drift back up and over the dark rift and go back up over the other side. But it should be hanging out here somewhere. It's going to be kind of difficult to track. Oh, there it is. This is it right here. So this will kind of drift up back up and over the dark rift, but this is the longline. It is said that longline fishing was developed by ancient Yafutonans as a way to effectively catch fish that don't travel in big schools. It is believed that this was one of the first long lines ever created. So that's interesting. I mean, I don't know how you really kind of reel that sucker back in, but I guess I'm not really supposed to worry about that. But anyway, okay, let me check out my discovery log, because I'm up against kind of where I'm thinking I'm going to split this into two episodes here. I still have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 13, 14. Nah, you know what? We'll keep chugging along. This will be a pretty long episode, but I'm going to go ahead and wrap this all up here. I'll kind of try to make the next few discoveries kind of quick. I'll just, you know, read through the description as fast as I can. But okay, all right, more discovery hunting. Hold on. Here we have the Stone Lovers. It is said that the tomb of a great Yafutoma king is hidden somewhere near this statue. The people of Yafutoma believe that this statue was carved after his death to show the love that his people had for him, and the love that he had for his wife. This is a small island that's just below in lower sky, just below Yafutoma, right there. On to the next one. And here are the Wanderbirds. The Wanderbirds are large migratory birds from the far north, revered since ancient times as symbols of long life. Their cry is rarely ever heard, but the clarity and beauty of their song is said to put all other birds to shame. Huh, even the giant rock that we just fought? Huh. Anyway, this is hanging out above just at the cloud ceiling, just north of Mount Kazai, and it just kind of flies off in the distance there. But this is your best bet on where to find it, so okay, on to the next one. Here we have the Mother Tree. This tree is revered by the Yafutomans. A lot of things are revered by the Yafutomans, it seems. In one of their ancient scriptures, it says that he who climbs to the top of this tree will someday conquer the world. The tree is now 2,000 years old. To this day, no one has ever made it to the top. Until today, I'm here! Ha 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 ha! Okay, maybe not. Alright, anyway, that's Tenku Island right in front of us. So this is an upper sky just south of Tenku Island. Next one! Just east of where I was when I found the mother tree is the Ryugu turtle. Once upon a time, an old man rescued a turtle who was being picked on by the neighborhood children. Thanking the old man, the turtle offered to give the old man a ride on his back. So into the sky they flew, to a faraway land. A Yafutoman legend. Next one. And here we have the Ryugu Island. And so the turtle brought the old man to an island of great beauty where the beautiful Princess Oto awaited. They laughed and ate and danced for days. When the turtle finally brought the old man home, 300 years had passed. So that's kind of a continuation of where we found the Ryugu turtle. This one's hanging out in the upper sky in Yafutoma area, right where my ship is, right there. Next one. And here we have the Sky Train. While a rare car of a similar nature currently exists in Valua, this flying train is believed to have once carried passengers between the lands of the Red, Green, and Purple Moons. Although no more passengers aboard, the Sky Train carries on. Why don't more passengers board? That's weird. Anyway, this one's hanging out just in upper sky above the Nazar Kingdom, right here, usually around the Dark Rift here. Next one. And here we have the Sky Coral. Microorganisms called sky coral attach themselves to moonstone boulders and grew to form these reefs. They flourish only in very specific conditions and can take 200 years to grow. Their various colors and shapes have long been valued for their beauty. This is in mid-sky, and I could have gotten this a long time ago, but I am basically just east of where Shrine Island is. Or Pirate Isle, rather. Well, Shrine Island and Pirate Isle. Here's where I am. Anyway, next one! And here we have the Inverse Isle, a strange island where the trees and everything else are upside down. The current theory is that this confusing phenomenon may be caused by a flux in the gravitational pull caused by the presence of the black moonstones at the center of the Dark Rift. This is straight north of Ryukan's Island, down in the southeast portion, you know what I mean. Anyway, southeast corner of the map, down here. Next one! And here we have the Mystic Orchard. Once upon a time, there was a faraway island where jeweled fruit grew on the trees. A young man took one of the fruits to cure his sick mother, but in return had to come back to the island to become one of the magical trees. A Yafutoman fairy tale. This one is directly west of the intersection of the Dark Rift and the White Stone Reef, right here. Next one. Here we have the Deep Iron Star. A metallic relic of the ancient world, legend has it that the ancients once harnessed the power of the blue moon to be able to detect sound waves to let them know when their enemies were approaching. Perhaps this machine once served such a purpose? This one's hanging out in lower sky, kind of going back and forth, east and west, in the very southern portion of the Yafutoman area. Next one! I forgot there was one more discovery just southwest of the Dancing Lights underneath the Valua. This is the Valuan Wreckage. 20 years ago, a flagship of the Armada disappeared above northern Nazrat near the end of the Valua-Nazar War.
Some theories mention a murder attempt on the commander of the Armada, but the mysterious disappearance has never been fully explained. Next one. Here we have the Flying Flail. An ancient history book shows records of contests of strength in which athletes would spin balls of steel at great speeds and launch them into the air to see whose ball traveled the farthest. Could this ball be from such a contest? Well, if it is, that guy certainly won because it is still flying. Anyway, this is on top and upper sky of Valua. I'm sitting here right, basically, it's kind of hard to see, right above the ancient palace that we found when we were finding the Maw of Tartus way long ago. Anyway, here I am on the map. It just kind of goes west to east from right here, but this is a good place to find it. Anyway, one more to go. Last one. Alright, so I had to resort to a little trick to find this last discovery just because it's such a huge pain to try to find it in a conventional manner. But anyway, I'm just above Gordo's Bistro when I first upload this save file, and this is what I'm looking for right here, the flutterflies. A butterfly that travels in groups in search of balloon flower nectar. Their remarkable endurance allows them to cross vast spans without sleeping or resting. Also, the silk produced by their larva is valued for its strength and resilience. Anyway, I'm going to get out of this ship's range here. But anyway, this discovery is incredibly hard to see. I mean, I'm so close to it and it's still so hard to see. And this group actually migrates almost halfway across the map. I'm in North Ocean right now and it migrates almost all the way to the North Dannel Strait. In the Nazar region. So, I mean, you can understand just how far that spans across all the way just about over here, back and forth through this area. So it's really, really hard to find at random. So if you search, I was searching for about 15 minutes just because I wanted to see if I could try to find it conventionally. But if you can't find it, just save your game on top of Gordo's Bistro and head south and you will find it. Anyway, alright, that's all of the discoveries except for one. I can't find the last discovery until later, but this will max out our discoveries for now. And so let me sell all of this information. I'm going to go to this guy just because he's the closest one. So let's see here. Hope you got a lot of money because I'm about to unload all of this information on you. Wow, 10 gold for the sky coral. Sorry, we've already received information on this. We'll still pay you for reconfirming it. Okay, well, that's one that Domingo, I guess, beat us to the punch to way early on in the game. But we are going to sell the rest of this stuff and get an enormous amount of gold for all of it. So you can just see the thousands of gold just rolling in. We started at about 100,000 gold before we started selling all this stuff, and you see how much the flutterflies cost. I mean, that's warranted. That's definitely the most difficult discovery to track down. But we've gotten well over 100,000 gold just from selling this information on discoveries. We're over 150,000 gold from all this stuff. I mean, goodness. So if you're, if you want some gold, just, go hunt down all these discoveries. It pays quite well. We've gotten about 250,000 gold just from discovery. So, whew, goodness. Okay. So let's get out of here, and I'm going to take a look at the journal real quick. And our discovery log is full, except for the very last discovery, which, as I mentioned earlier, we can't find until a little bit later on, but that's okay. So all the discoveries are accounted for, all of the giant monsters are accounted for. Man, we've done quite a bit. I'm sorry this episode is a little bit long, but it had to be done at some time, so I'm glad to clean all that up in one fell swoop here. I'm gonna go ahead and save over this last most recent file. Don't need that anymore. So anyway, hope you enjoyed this global tour, finding all the discoveries with me. So next time, I think we are ready to advance the story and go into the underground Maw of Tartus and see if we can get our hands on the final moon crystal. Fina mentioned that the elders have her elders, or whoever she came from, already have the silver moon crystal, so all we need to track down is the yellow moon crystal. So we'll see what we can do about that next time, but thanks for joining me this time. Hope you enjoyed it. And come back again next time, and we'll see how much further we can get in the story. So until then, you guys take care, and I'll see y'all next time for more Let's Play Skies of Arcadia Legends.